Okay, can you tell us about your 17 years in the Air Force? Some of the high points?
There's been a lot, in the Air Force, there were a lot of high points. I think the best thing that ever happened was when we started to do all of them on the road. And because when we had one location, and the temperature like it is now, people were coming in to the audience just to get warm, to get off the street, you know. Mm-hmm. So they were not really that keen. And they were rather blasé. But then when we started taping every show in a different city, we had this tremendous, exciting response every single time, because it was a big occasion. They're all done as fundraisers for various organizations, and so you had this very excited and excitable audience. And they're still doing it. They're taping right now in Yellowknife. I haven't been doing it as much recently. I have a one-man show I've been doing in theaters.
What's that all about?
Well, the one-man show is about everything that's going on in the world, and I do some characters in the second half of the show. I do Sergeant Renfrew, and I do a little bit of an evangelist, and I do an old man rescuing a boy on a bridge, and what else do I do? Oh, little bits of vignettes in the second half. But a lot of it is topical monologue about what's happening in the world. I even do a little bit of Dan Quayle at one point.
Sergeant Renfrew is probably one of the most memorable characters. How did that come about?
Well, that was an article. Sergeant Renfrew wasn't called that at that time. It was just an article about what might happen if you were caught up in, and by mistake ended up in the RCMP. It was written by Eric Nickel. And that gave me the basic idea for doing it. And I wrote to him and asked him how he'd feel about me making that into a stage piece. And he said, because it had been taken from a newspaper and put in a book. And he said, if a publisher doesn't mind, I don't mind. So I sent him royalties for a long time. But then it evolved and got a name and changed. And then over the years of Air Force, we did dozens of them.
So now you have a copyright on Julian Austin, is that it?
Well, I suppose. I haven't really looked into that, but... It sure has been a successful thing, and surprising, you know, how much the RCMP themselves love it. I mean, I did it at headquarters in Ottawa, and they gave me five standing ovations. And, you know, when you think of it, a policeman who takes his intellectual guidance from a dog, it's wonderful that they like it that much. No, actually, I do it without malice, and so that's why. They love it because it humanizes the role of the police officer.
Also, it's such a Canadian symbol. I mean, a Hollywoodized version of Canada. Is that have a sort of resonance within Canada?
Within Canada, yeah. It does not. It's nothing to do outside of Canada. No, when I'm outside, I learned a long time ago the best thing I can do is just be Dave Broadfoot, because a Mountie, especially over in England. A Mountie is a kind of fantasy character to them. The scarlet tunic and the hat and the horse and all. They don't realize that in this country, a Mountie is in their life from the day you're born. They're involved with immigration. They're involved with drug enforcement. They're involved with parking your car at the airport. Their water safety, Coast Guard. In the whole provinces, they are the entire force. We have provincial police here, but in other provinces, they don't. Some other provinces.
What are you going to say in the next 30 minutes of your session?
Well, I'll be talking about what people have written about comedy and what I think it is and why I think it's important, how I go about producing it, the writing of the comedy, and satire. I always remember there was some American said that satire is what closes on Saturday night. And that's been used as gospel ever since, especially in the motion picture industry. I don't believe that at all. I mean, Hitler said he wouldn't make war, but that doesn't make it correct. You know, satire, I think Air Force does a lot of satire, and it's been very successful. I did Spring Thaw, a stage show here for 10 years. That went on for about 30 years. Very successful. My own show that I'm doing is full of satire, and so I think it's viable. I think it's in a democracy, you need to be able to to make fun of your institutions to keep it healthy. You know, and I think that's what freedom speech is all about. When you see, you know, in the United States, there isn't a country in the world that talks more about freedom than U.S. citizens. And yet, when you see their theater and the stage shows, I mean, stage musicals, watch television, the idea of being bold and free is to have invite 10 prostitutes on Geraldo Rivera, and they discuss the various weird ways they have of satisfying their customers. And in fact, when I played that back, I found it even more disturbing. I'm going to start recording the show. No, but anyway, freedom to come on stage nude, or freedom to do cheeky nude sex things on television or in film, is a very limited and, to me, childlike response to freedom. If you talk and you do all that and never discuss in comedy or satire what's happening in your country, the political things, the sociological things that are happening to women, to gay people, to black people, to native people, and if you leave all of that out, what's the point of freedom if you're afraid to use it? You know, that's my view anyway.
Well, is there any difference between Canada producing an astounding number of satirists?
Yes.
Which later on make itself off the border.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any explanations to why Canada does such a
No, I really don't know why. I like the kind of humor. I mean, I find people in this country respond very well to humor that's got some bite to it, you know. I thought all of those fellows and women who went to Hollywood were extremely talented, all of them. Martin Short and Andrea and Catherine O'Hara and Dave, John Candy and all that whole Reitman and so many. And then there was a whole batch before them. I mean, before the Dave Thomases and the Rick Moranises and all those, there was a whole gang that went when I was young. They were writers mainly, and ended up writing things like The Flying Nun, he went on. That was Bernie Slade. I mean, he wrote Same Time Next Year, a stage show. He wrote so many wonderful stage plays and endless television shows. All these people I worked with live in Hollywood, and I'm working here.
Were you ever sent to
people down in Hollywood? Oh, yeah. I had invitations. Nothing ever came of it. The only thing I ever did on television in the United States was the Ed Sullivan Show. But I suppose if someone was to come and make me an offer, I would certainly not turn it down. I mean, I'd like to have that world exposure. But, I mean, when you say USA, because it's like it reaches so many other markets. But on the other hand, I'm not about to abandon Canada. Certainly, if I was going to do it, I would have done it a long time ago. I've always enjoyed my work here. I have no complaints at all. It's been very rewarding, and I'm very happy with the audience acceptance.
Are you a Canadian?
Yes, by choice, but I was born and raised in North Vancouver, B.C., and I don't know what happened to me, but all my family are missionaries, except myself.
Missionaries?
Yes.
How do you get from missionary to satirist?
Well, I don't know, because, you know, I went through a metamorphosis. When I was very young, I was very deeply involved with religion, and I mean, when I was 10, 11, 12, 13 years old, and I was going to be a missionary myself. But as time went on, and I joined the Merchant Navy and sailed all over the world during the last part of the war, Second World War, I started to change dramatically. And one of the things that happened to me that changed my life was I was in the middle of the Atlantic, and I started to think about all the fellows in my crew, and I started to think about their names, which I'd never done before, and they were all Francophone, except me. And I realized that, you know, if we had been hit in convoy, I would have given my life for them, and they would have given their lives for me. And all of a sudden, all this hostility that I was brought up with, this anti-Catholic nonsense that I had from birth, the anti-French thing that I had from birth, the anti-Quebec thing, which I grew up with in North Vancouver, it all just fell apart because it didn't. It was all, to me, a pack of lies, you know, because here I am, I don't even realize I'm working with a total shipload of Francophones. And they were my best buddies. I mean, we were life and death situation together. So that was the end of that. And then that started to change me a lot. And I, from then on, I really worked. And I, in my work, if you'll hear my presentation, I talk a lot about that, about bigotry. And I feel at this moment in this country, it's just a growth industry. And to walk away from that is crazy. We have to talk about it and joke about it. You know, in the United States, they have this group called U.S. English. Well, it's exactly the same thing. They're worried about Spanish, you see, language. And here we have APEC. And the APECers and the, well, I guess that's not a good expression, but they actually, some of their funding comes from U.S. English. And they have this, I just don't understand it. The feeling is, a fellow, Ron Leach is the boss. And he was inspired by a book written by a certifiable loony called, the book is called Bilingual Today, French Tomorrow. And this man is a certifiable xenophobe because he says Quebec is a breeding pen for the eventual taking over of all of Canada. Now, if you can imagine, a breeding pen with the lowest birth rate in the world, you know, the man is...
He is a retired...
Army officer, yeah. And I mean, to say that, so actually all this worry about them separating and becoming independent is all a ploy. They're really about to take us over. And I can see that future with Rocket Richard, forcing all the men to become hockey players and put Grecian formula in their hair, and these Quebec women, these teachers will be coming out and shoving the French tongue down our throats. It's going to be a nightmare. I'm scared, but I'm scared for a different reason. I'm scared because of the APECers who are going. They're getting signing up members all over the country. They're making all these towns. See, we have this competitive system in Canada. In Quebec, somebody starts a fire in Saint-Basile-le-Grand, a tragic fire. So we have to have one in Ontario, in Hagersville. Someone's got to go start a fire and burn these tires. Then they start in Quebec, they have the unilingual signs. And so we have to have unilingual cities. And it's all being done by adults, which I find hard to believe. But the way the unilingual thing works, the mayor says, we're going to declare, let's declare our town unilingual. And the councilors say, who will this help? And the mayor says, nobody. And the councilors say, let's do it. Hard to believe. But it's happening every day.
The resources that you see to the topic of satire seem to be all political, which is part and parcel of creating satire.
Yeah.
And, of course, lampoon politics and lampoon all kinds of stuff. But is there a pet project right now that you're working on?
Not a pet project, no. I tell you, I don't even... Even in religion, you know, even given my background, I have always been offended by the idea of televangelists building empires on the backs of poor, frightened, lonely, old people. And I think it's scandalous. And so, from that base, you see, there has to be a base for everything in life. And what it ends up on stage is outrageous comedy and people are laughing hysterically. But you have to start from somewhere. Or you wouldn't write it. And so I consciously have done evangelist routines over and over again. At the beginning, I wondered, now how do you do this without offending those in the audience who really are sincerely caring Christian or whatever they are, or whatever religion, without offending them? Because there can't be malice in anything you do. Absolutely not, because that's divisive. And so I thought, well, and the first thing I came up with was Mother Goose. To portray Mother Goose as satanic verses, you know, the satanic message implicit in each of the Mother Goose stories. And it worked a treat. And then I did another one. And I never wanted to use actual biblical quotes. But you know what? I am doing one right now. And it's based on Deuteronomy. And the first time I tried it out, I hadn't thought about where I was. I was for a Jewish school in Vancouver, a Torah. And I did the thing, and it got an incredibly positive response. And then I thought, oh my goodness, what am I doing in front of this audience? And after some of the rabbis came over to me and they said, Dave, I just wish it was possible. One of them said, for you to stay an extra day in Vancouver and have you come to my class at the school and do that, what you've done here on Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy said, we'll never be the same.
Excellent interpretation and satire.
Yeah, but you have to be careful because I did it subsequently in Wisconsin, and a woman came up to me afterwards, and she was white, absolutely white. I don't mean white skin, but white with apoplexy. She was hyperventilating, and she said, you made fun of God. And I said, well, God has made fun of me. And that's all I could think to say at the moment. I didn't want to defend it because I didn't want to make her more upset. But, you know, you have to be mindful of those things because we're not in business to be divisive. I mean, that's going on, and I don't think that's a comedian's job.
There are some comedians who, honestly, many Jews who are very, very biting in the satire. This is not the type of satire that you're involved with.
Oh, yeah, I make stronger points when I'm on stage. Oh, yeah. Well, no, I don't, I'm not interested in making people feel bad. I mean, I have to try and make people laugh about, now, for instance, I just did this great big a convention here of municipal politicians at the Royal York Hotel, and my opening thing was doing the news, and talking about the unilingual thing. I said another small Ontario town is moving towards declaring itself unilingual. The mayor spoke out on the issue today. He said that we are not anti-French. We don't want no French spoke at work. We want for that our kids should have spoke because it's economic, eh? Well, our kids should have spoke just as good of English as we done. And so putting it that way, you see, they were laughing because, I mean, this guy's defending English. And then I talked about the other group and saying that their spokesman had said that the French were not a founding race, Quebec is an indistinct society, and Louis Riel was an Anglo-Saxon who only spoke French to annoy people. And they were laughing, you know, I mean, I was socking all this stuff out to them about what's happening, and the next day a serious politician spoke to them. And a whole bunch of them got up and walked out. So, you know why they walked out? Because she started to speak in French.
Let's talk about union economy.
Yeah.
Is there a distinctive East Coast, West Coast type of union?
Well, yeah, there is. I mean, there is a certain East Coast approach to humor. There are certain jokes that they tell each other that are very special. But by and large, I found as a touring performer for years and years and years, when we toured years ago with Spring Thaw, as we went from Victoria right across to end the season in Charlottetown, I never found any real difference except in Toronto and Winnipeg. The audiences were most reserved. Montreal, they were most explosive. They were just so excited. It was incredible. Every time we went there, we had this, there was double the enthusiasm of anywhere else. But, you know, when I say reserved, that can sometimes be the physical building you're working in can create that. You can go to a city and play in one theater, and it's just incredible. And then go and play in a different theater, and the physical thing, because there's a proscenium stage and there's a bit of a barrier and you're not really in the audience, it can have an effect on the responsiveness. So I don't want to say that, but every time we went through, Winnipeg was always the tougher audience. And then Toronto was not quite as tough because, you know, we built our name here over all those years. But anyway, I didn't find the reaction very different coast to coast.
You're in town, do you have any particular anecdotes that stand out?
Oh, well, I think one of the most incredible moments for a show was in Edmonton. And we were doing a sketch, a half-hour sketch for the Air Force, where we kept cutting back to studio, like the anchor man at the desk giving the update on the news events that we were reporting on, and that we saw them unfolding, and then we'd have another update. Well, one of the news anchor people's name was Ron Boyd Muckfuster. And when the fellow playing the part, John Morgan, came to say his name, he transposed the syllables. So you can imagine how it came out. Ron Boyd Muckfuster came out quite differently. And he just, I've never seen him like that. He just went white with fear and in shock and so stunned at what he'd said.
Did it bring the house down?
Oh, well, yeah, it did. It brought me down. And I remember Don Ferguson fell on the stage laughing, and several people were corpsed over each other laughing. It was just it was an incredibly funny moment. And I said that I was leaving because I wanted to get a good seat in the cruiser with the cops after hearing that. But anyway, it was a really funny. That's because it's totally unexpected. And the best comedy is always what's unexpected. I had a night where I fell off. No, I didn't fall off. Somebody else. We only had blackout, and the girl I was working with vanished. She fell off the stage onto a concrete floor and crawled back during the blackout, and no one even saw it happen. It was amazing. She was a wreck afterwards. We found her in the fire escape. But nothing. I remember falling down a staircase when I was entertaining the troops in the Sinai Desert. Those are incredible things, going into the Golan Heights and the Sinai Desert, UN troops. Yeah. I had an awful experience in Japan at the United Nations Hospital. We were going and performing in the wards, and I went into this wards and I saw all these fellows in their blue pajamas, and I thought they were black American GIs, you know. What did I know? I mean, no one said anything, so I started performing. And the whole ward, you know, and nothing was happening, nothing. And I was doing more, and I was perspiring and trying to make it better and funnier and going. And then they started to laugh. Right near the end, they started laughing. And then when I came out in the hallway, this nurse who was guiding us along, or Red Cross worker, she said, "Did you enjoy performing for the Ethiopians?" I said, "You couldn't tell me that before. I could have at least cut my time." But however, I didn't know they're Ethiopians. They looked like black American, you know, they looked like GIs to me. I thought that they were.
Do you ever work on a script that simply doesn't work on stage?
I guess not for a long time. Not for a long time. Yeah, we yeah, well, that's true. Even in Air Force in the early days, we would once in a while come up with a real clunker. And John Morgan had written a piece that was involving a lot of ethnic dancing for a radio show. I mean, it's just ludicrous. But he wanted the audience there to understand, so he made us put on these paper hats. For the Dutch dance, we were to wear these. And it was just nothing. No response right through from the beginning. So now when we get into a difficult situation, someone will say, "Get the Dutch hats out." I can remember doing a blackout and a live television show in Montreal with a bunch of actors, all in the period costumes. A lot of work for a blackout. But, you know, a blackout, something which lasts about a minute at the most. And We got to the punchline, it was dead silent. And we're supposed to hold it, you know, while the camera's still on it. So I was stood there. Finally, the red light went off, and then I walked forward and made a little speech. I said, well, normally at the end of a sketch like this, because the audience is sitting there in silence, hundreds of them. I said, normally at the end of a piece like that, there is a punchline, and it's got such a surprise element in it that the whole audience breaks up with laughter. And then we capture that on moment on the camera and the sound, and then we have a viable piece of material. However, I said on this occasion, I just was going on and on like this, and normally and all the actors were in hysterics because I was doing an academic explanation about what a blackout is. And I couldn't think of anything else to do. I mean, it was absolutely, we were mortified. You just can't walk away and pretend it didn't happen. So I went on with this great long explanation, and then the audience started to laugh, and everything was saved.
Not really. Just one last question, sort of a personal question. How did it feel to be at the Ed Sullivan Show? I mean, this must have been the height of
fun. Well, it was fine, but it could have been an awful lot better. I came there at noon. He told me to be there at noon, and he was tied up right up until. Now, this is a live show going at 8 o'clock. He didn't talk to me until 7 o'clock. And at 7:15, he took me up to his office and started to rewrite my act, edit my material. He said, you can't say that. We've got troops in Korea. You can't say this. You can't say that. No, I'll go back to what you did in Toronto at the CNE Grandstand Show. And I said, I was talking about Canadian politicians. He said, well, it's the same here. Oh, boy. So I just had to do the best I could at the last minute. It was a real panic situation because he was insistent. And he insisted on the timing and the edits. Wow, to walk on stage in front of millions of people with all that tumbling around in your head trying to figure out where the hell you are. It's so unfair, you know, so unfair. He's dead now. I'm not, so I'm not going to do the Ed Sullivan Show again, but if I ever do anything like that, I never allow those things to happen. Never.
Thank you very much.
You're more than welcome. May the forest be with you.